Are we on for this? Kuka bhai, can you give me a cue jakhon ora ready? Ora jakhon ready amake ekta awaz dite parben? Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the 21st lecture of the Bengal public lecture series. It's been quite a journey, and the good news is we have already published quite a few of our talks online on our YouTube channel. You should visit it. It's a very easy URL, youtube.com/Bengal Institute videos. Recently, we have actually uploaded the entire conference, entire symposium that we organized in March this year. So all the talks and discussions that we videotaped are now up there. And we have started this new experiment. Not exactly new, we actually did this before. That is, this event is being streaming live online on our YouTube channel. So if anybody is out there, hello to the internet. Today we have our guest, Andreas Ruby. He's the director of Swiss Architecture Museum. And I'd like to invite Meina Tabassum here on stage to introduce him.
Okay, good evening to everybody. Welcome to our Bengal Institute lecture series that we generally organize as a public event. Though our academic sessions are not running now, but Andreas happened to be here for a different reason, which is they are organizing an interesting exhibition of Bangladesh architecture. Hopefully he'll talk about it a little bit in his talks. So Andreas Ruby, as you heard, is the director of Swiss Architecture Museum, which is based in Basel. Andreas Ruby is not an architect, formally not an architect. At the same time, he's not a Swiss, but he is the director of the Swiss Architecture Museum, which is kind of an interesting thing to find. Well, he is not trained as an architect, but he has had a very, I would say, immense interest. His immense interest in architecture led him towards architecture. And in a way, he decided not to be formally educated. It was a conscious decision and not to be trained as an architect, but to be on the other side, so that he had an entirely different understanding of architecture. And so in a way, he's passionate and he has been contributing immensely it's also his, I would say, his trade in architecture. He is a writer, he's a critic, architectural theorist. He has an immense body of work that he has done up till now. Besides being the director of the Swiss Architecture Museum, he's also running a publishing house, which is the Ruby Press, through which he has published with his wife, Ilka Ruby, that they have established this publishing house where they are working on different kind of books on architecture. I met Andreas 4 times this year, which is quite unique. First, we met in Salzburg, Austria, and then in Dubai, then in Basel, and now here in Dhaka. So within these four visits, we've talked a lot about a lot of things. So one thing I found quite interesting is that Andreas was born in Dresden, and he was brought up during the DDR times. And as you know, that was a socialist time, and his interest, he had immense interest in world as such. And so far I heard from him that he took a job in a hotel, right? So that he could interact with international guests. So that became his window to the world. And then of course, after the reunification, that, you know, took him much further, and now he's all over the world. We all know his name, and he's making an immense contribution to architecture in that sense. He has also taught in different universities, which includes the University of Kassel, Cornell University, Polytechnique University of Lausanne, and Barcelona. So without me talking anything anymore, I would like to invite Andreas to the stage to give us an immense talk. Thank you.
As I'm a guest in your country and as a guest to the Bengali Institute, I would like to give a little present, because that's how we do it when we are somewhere. This is the first book that we did at Ruby Press in 2008, when we really had no clue how publishing works, because I'm basically an amateur. I do things out of love and not out of, like some paper proofs that I can do it. And then we made a book that has, it's called Urban Transformation, and it's basically about cities all over the world that are all in transformation. And basically in the end, I think this fits very well to Dhaka. And also to basically make clear that this book is about things that are still in development, we also tried to make a book that is in itself in transformation, because basically it's not really bound completely, but has this open binding. And what happens is when you open that, it falls completely flat, you know? This is what it couldn't do, it was completed. So here's an homage to the incomplete. Thank you. This device, where is it? Good. Tell you need to help me. Something isn't. Okay, sorry. Thanks, Tawad, again. He set this stage up and his team in a really wonderful way. I think this is better than ETH school in Zurich in terms of technical sophistication and inventiveness. Just the way that the sound travels over this stage is quite remarkable. And I love the stage that is so set up like a home with the plants and a nice chair that you want to sit on. This is really nice. Thank you for hosting me in such a nice way. I want to talk about architecture and identity today, because for me, one of the most interesting things about architecture is that it can work as a catalyst of change. It can organize change, it can choreograph change. And I think change is what we are all exposed to all the time. We are living in a world where we cannot afford to just stay the same, because change happens, and whether we like it or not. So we have to somehow accommodate that change. And architecture in its very slow speed, I think, can teach us, I think, in a very poetic way, how that can happen. How we, with all our way of being and our understanding of how we are, can actually also become someone different. Because buildings do that all the time. We just need to observe them. But before I really go into this, I would really like to say I was really, really happy to come to this country, because this is the first country that made me come and assure me that I'm not a tourist. Found this beautiful poster in the National Parliament, where we were yesterday, and I think this is quite remarkable if a national tourist agency makes that kind of statement. And so I'm happy to be here, not as a tourist, but as someone else. in fact, this experience, I have to come back to it, was one of the highlights of my architectural socialization. I mean, ever since I'm studying architecture. I studied history of art, so we studied a lot of ancient architecture, cathedrals, temples, and that kind of stuff. And at some point, I realized there's something like modern architecture, and I stumbled upon this building. And I thought, well, one moment, at one point in my life, I want to see this thing. And this was yesterday. And actually, every architect that I know has that kind of longing. So I think you're really blessed to have the most beautiful parliament in the world. Because actually, our parliament, my German parliament, looks like this. It's kind of tough, right? It's kind of a monster, kind of blockbuster building sitting in the landscape and basically being not incredibly inviting. Cannes is also quite a monster, but a beautiful monster, right? I mean, it's heavy, but it's inviting. It has these openings. It draws you in. You want to go into that building when you see it. And then you find out it's quite difficult. In this building, I didn't really want to go in at first because it looked so tough. It also has to do with the fact that this building has a very difficult history. This is one of the most traumatic buildings in the history of German democracy, because this is the building in which the National Socialists, the Nazis, buried our democracy in 1933, where they basically eliminated the put out of power the elected democratic government and installed their dictatorship. This is one of the most troublesome moments in our history, and because of course you know what followed afterwards. And it was very interesting when then Germany was divided. This Berlin, after World War II, there was East Germany, West Germany. This was in West Berlin, which officially was part of West Germany, even though it lay as an island in East Germany. So this building could not be parliament anymore because Berlin was not allowed to be the capital of West Germany anymore by the Allied forces, simply because the city was almost like considered too dangerous. It had such a troublesome history, it was contaminated, kind of. So that building stood empty for, basically 4 decades. And there was this interesting, and Bonn became the capital, a very small provincial town, kind of had a difficult time to cope with that responsibility. And then afterwards, after the reunification, Berlin became capital again, because now it was okay enough to do so, to be so. And the question became, well, this was the parliament. Can we go there in again? And people said, well, no, not there. At the very place of the political bloodshed of our freedom, can we go there again? And there was a very, very interesting project of an artist who says, yes, you can do that. Buildings transform. Buildings have not one identity that is single and static all over the time. And just because one building was under control by dictators or even erected by dictators, as we have other buildings by the Nazis in Berlin, that doesn't mean that they are contaminated like some nuclear waste for the rest of their lifetime. No, buildings should transgress and transcend the ideology and the ideas of their makers. Because there's this beautiful moment of the afterlife, the post-occupancy of a building, where new intentions come into play, where new ideas, new practices become important. And this happened, and Christo and Jean-Claude, these were the two artists that made this project that you probably know very well, made this very incredible project where they talked to every single of the 540 members of our parliament over a process of 20 years and individually convinced them to say, yes, we can do that. And they said, we will make a project that will heal this building in a way, that will change it, that will free it of all kinds of bad kind of spirits and so on. It was this. They wrapped it for 14 days, just 2 weeks. It took them basically 20 years to convince our politicians to make this, and it was so successful. Every day was crowded like this. I remember lying on the grass there. And people were basically happy to to have been given in return, like some lost child or uncle that you thought was dead, is given back to you. And they said, wow, all this space we can use. That's fantastic. And they said, basically it was like a party. It was in the summer. It was, there was things going on day and night. And it was so popular that politicians afterwards, or like at the end of the 14 days, asked the artist whether they can prolong it, you know? 20 years to convincing time, 14 days of actual sort of changing their minds. And you see what an impact a building has, whether you make an argument in a discussion, a meeting, or whether you have a whole space that embodies its own dynamics, makes obviously a big difference. And these 14 days changed the way that our society looked at that building and at ourselves. It made people convinced that maybe a society can grow and outgrow traumas, because that was a trauma for us. And sometimes all it takes is to take a distance towards what's so familiar. And it was really interesting. The minute this thing was wrapped, people were start to wondering and asking themselves, how does it actually look? How many levels does it have? Was it two, three? How was this cornice? How many windows? You couldn't, you know, for the first time when you couldn't see it anymore, you actually wanted to look at it. This is quite an interesting moment, I think. And after that project, which was really hugely successful, then they started, they made the decision, yes, we can do this, and they made they started the building process, the transformation process of Norman Foster's project that you see here. Nowadays, this building, even though in together is not, to my mind, a really beautiful building, is one of the most popular buildings of all buildings in Germany. It has, and that has to do with the fact that now, first of all, with Christo's transformation, but secondly also with the fact that there's an addition on it, there's this cupola, glass cupola, where there's a ramp inside, and you can, it spirals inside the glass. You can actually touch the glass like this. And you go up, and there's a platform, a viewing platform up on top. And on the roof of the old building, there's one of the best restaurants in town, and you just can just go there and, you know, take out your friends that come from another city. It is a bit cumbersome to get inside, but basically you book it on the internet. You get a slot, a time slot. I think you pay something. You cross through a security change, and that's it. So we can basically inhabit our parliament. And if there was one wish that I still had left in my otherwise completely filled soul yesterday after visiting the parliament of Louis Kahn here in Bangladesh, in Dhaka, it was that this building could be public in the same way. But maybe that is spoken as an idealist, but you know, sometimes reality catches up. basically what this is all about is really summed up in the most beautiful way by this quote from Samuel Beckett. To have been always what I am, and so different from what I was. That's a beautiful grammatical paradox. You know, it doesn't really work in terms of kind of the terms. But it's really what this is all about. Is there a notion in which change and stasis is not a contradiction? Can we change in a way that we don't lose ourselves? That we still keep track of our roots, but are not tied to them as if we were hand-tied? And especially in the Western culture, we have a little bit that problem. We're infatuated with our origin, and want to always come back to this, and this impedes us at certain times to actually go ahead and also move forward. There's a certain fear that by moving forward you could actually lose what defines you, and I think there's nothing more wrong than that kind of belief. And it was architecture that taught me that this is wrong, because architecture sort of makes those changes visible all the time. This is probably my single most loved, my favorite project of architecture and urbanism of all times. You actually cannot really see this building right there. You look at a city, the city of Split in Croatia, which when this building was built in the 3rd century after Christ, was a Roman city called Spalato. And it's a city where a Roman emperor, Emperor Diocletian, decided to settle down for his retirement. He was one of the few Roman emperors who did that. All the others died either killed or they died out of age because they couldn't step down. He stepped down. I think this is a great decision, right? Step down when you are not you don't have to. That's a sign of sovereignty and of actual power, I think. Because he realized maybe there's something else in politics. Maybe there's the good life. Maybe there's the Mediterranean. I can go to the beach every day. How much more interesting is that than just simply being around and solving other people's problems? So he built a retirement villa there, which you see there, but in a transformed way. I'm not going to show you where it is, but it's somewhere there. It's rather large. It's 180 by 220 meters or 200 meters long. So it gives you a sense of scale. And originally, archaeologists think it looked like that. I mean, being a Roman emperor, you can't just come up with some tiny house, you know? You have to have something large. And so this is actually almost like a small city in the typological form of a fortress. You see these indications of the city basically by the Cardo and Decumanus, the two axes of the Roman city. And then it has these very strong walls. And in the four quadrants, apparently there were different types of programs in that almost made it a city in terms of there was living, there was working, and leisure functions. So this building took 10 years to build, which is almost unbelievable for the size. And he lived in it 10 years, and then he died. And after that, it was empty for centuries, and it got destroyed in the migrational wars in the 5th to the 7th century. It was destroyed, it stood empty, nobody knew what to do with it. And then only in the 15th century, Venetian pirates, actually, who colonized the Adriatic coast, came to Split and said, wow, this is actually quite interesting. Let's do something with it. Now, to understand what was left, we see this plan. Everything that's black is still there. You can physically trace it to the original building. All in all, it would look like this. So that shows all the actual building materials still original, both in the first floor and in the ground floor. But how did it change? How does it look today? Like this. And this moment is just magic for me. The Venetians kind of understood, because they built a Venetian town next to this castle. And when that town grew, it hit against the walls of the fortress and said, oh, what are we going to do now? Earlier on, people wouldn't demolish buildings because it was too much of an effort, and you would just transform it, incorporate it, adapt it. And they did that here too, even though you have to imagine the walls of that fortress were they're bigger, they're deeper than a meter, I think a meter 50 or so. So it's quite some digging if you want to make some digging, and they did. You see actually how this thick wall here is eaten away by houses built either outside or inside of it. And you have this system of streets. It's really this Italian feeling. It's like Venice without water somehow. And some original buildings are kept. This is the mausoleum where his grave is, Emperor Diocletian's one. That's a temple. So whatever was still usable, another temple was kept, and everything else was just added. Now, how does this look? It looks extravagantly cool. It is a palimpsest of 3 to 4 layers all rolled into one in a way that you cannot distinguish anymore which is original, which is later. So our heritage people would, you know, they go crazy with a building like this because they cannot be good bureaucrats and say, well, this is original, this is later, the later has to go. So here everything seems to be valid, and exactly that's the point. You see really a couple of layers of different facades all superimposed into each other. Sometimes you can kind of guess what is Roman, sometimes not. So for instance, these buildings here are obviously placed later against the wall. That's a building added later on top of the elevated floor that's inside this whole thing. You see here, for instance, there are some of the original windows which are then closed. That's a square inside. And again, you have this kind of Baroque palazzo here. And then again, three different generations of buildings over each other. Then you see the interior has been filled entirely by these streets and houses. And people make, you know, invent new uses for old functions, such as those things which were, you know, military devices, so to cover and shoot your enemy, are now used to drying laundry. What a smart use of a quite sort of terrible device. Here we have a hotel owner who said it would be nice to have a hotel here because there's room. Okay, I just built one here. And then they figured out, okay, actually it would also not be such a bad idea to have daylight in rooms of hotels. But we can only have them here and not on the other side. What to do with this? Well, you drill a hole until you get a window. Doors are also helpful at times, and they added one here. And what happens? The neighbor replicates that thing. And over time, you have the unfolding of a new typology, which is a row housing typology growing out of this ancient fortress. Now, this process, I think, is utterly intelligent, I think, to allow buildings to learn new uses. I'm very inspired by Stuart Brand's book, How Buildings Learn, What Happens After They're Built. It's a beautiful book that is all about this process that happens once a building is finished, which is this ludicrous idea. I think a building is never finished, but architects like to say, well, I finished this building here. These are my projects, but this is my finished work. And I would say it's very sad. If a building was finished the minute it was handed over by the architect to the client. No, this is, to me, to use an analogy, this is the birth. So like when we have a baby born, we don't say, well, look at my finished child. No, it's not finished. It just begins to live. And that's the beautiful thing. So the building process, for me, is the pregnancy of an architectural project. And everything that comes afterwards is its life. And in this kind, if you allow a building to take its life, you get the most beautiful, poetic productions that no architect can ever dream up. So for me here, this is, oh, I'm sorry, I was too quick. For me, this is an incredibly interesting moment where you see, for instance, these big Roman windows that were too big for any of the later generations to make use of are then filled with brick. Sometimes they also say, well, one window is okay, so let's put one. But then it's also interesting, it's kind of a slapstick moment of architectural history. Instead of placing it really inside that field, no, actually they do it at the corner where they actually have to cut away some of the heavy stone. But then that gives them room for the AC, you know, they also need that. And my favorite detail of this, and which reminds me a lot of the beautiful kind of classicism, neoclassicism of Asplund and Leverans, two architects I like a lot, is this door. Because can't you also help wondering what happens to the guy that uses it? I always think it must be Buster Keaton coming out there next moment and falling down and breaking a leg, probably. So this is how this place looks now. It's very alive. And the interesting thing is, normally in architectural projects, you always get a beginning date and a completion date, right? Completed then, finished then. Well, in this project, you can't do this. It's still ongoing. And this is how architecture should work all the time. Now, can we make use of this type of ideal of architecture? Tawud, how am I doing with this microphone? Am I too close? Should I step back a little bit? It's okay? Good. Because I received some instructions. This is a very interesting moment. This is a city I lived in quite some time, Cologne. And Cologne was, like my native city, Dresden, heavily bombed during World War II. And both cities were bombed in the center in atrocious ways. And so what we're looking at now is really the center of Cologne. And there was a church, which you see here, or part of the church you see there, and was destroyed quite heavily. And then when the city was still all in ruins, one of the first buildings they made was this. It's called Maria in the Ruins by Gottfried Böhm, who is one of the great German architects of post-war history. And What is amazing about this building, it's actually a whole family of architects, Dominikus Böhm, Gottfried Böhm, Peter Böhm, they can't just, you know, whenever they make a baby, it will be an architect, you know. So this building was very heroic in the sense that it stood there when all the rest around it was still ruins. It was the first beginning of hope, right? And it's a quite a small chapel. They decided, which I find interesting, not to rebuild the entire church, but make a small chapel that also talks about the pain of the actual building to be gone. And this project then was a place of a very interesting controversy when Peter Zumthor won a competition for this building, which was supposed to be the museum of the church in Cologne for all its artworks, which is quite an incredible collection. It looks like this. And what you now see is that this small chapel is no longer small, it's tiny, right? And the architect, who was still alive, was quite mad at Peter Zumthor for having done that, because he felt it's wrong and it's miniaturized and it's banalized and it's kind of dominated by this big building. And there was like 5 years they had an argument, these two architects. You have to imagine they would sit together over a bottle of wine and having arguments on end, and apparently Zumthor was so stubborn that the other guy just gave up. And so sometimes that's also a strategy in negotiating, right? To just don't bother and keep insisting. I understand both points of view. I find it a little bit of a pity that I cannot experience the situation before, but I also find the value in this new project, which said, I want to build on this building, like in the Diocletian Palace, be seen before, you know? And it's quite a beautiful moment, because when you get inside, you see this diaphanous wall of bricks. It's a technique that I see here quite a lot, which is interesting when you want to make a building like able to be ventilated naturally. So here, that's the same thing. There's this porous wall that is built right on the ruins of the building that was destroyed. And then you see here, this is the chapel that was built by Böhm, Maria and den Trümmern, with its beautiful stained glass windows. And it's now kind of wrapped around, you know, it's like some helpful ghost reaching around and embracing that building. And you can walk over a series of bridges to see the ruins, also the traces, the archaeological traces of the buildings that were built before that building that was destroyed, because this building has a long building history of about 1,500 years. And architecturally speaking, I think it's one of the more remarkable projects that were built in, I think, Western contemporary architecture during the past two decades. It's quite a powerful thing, and it's done with great care. You know, the brick that was used here was actually fabricated just for this building, in terms of finding a balance, or let's say a sort of a balance between sameness and difference to the old building. The idea is, of course, that the brick will age. This new brick, which will age over time, because we have pollution and other things, and you know, building materials age, to the older building. Now let's see whether this actually will happen. This is how it looks today, all in all. Now this is a very heroic building. Now it's very accepted, meanwhile, and I think also the architect of the chapel kind of made its peace with it, I hope. And because also architect isn't really so important to have lifelong arguments, I think. One should accept that a building is always the expression of a multitude of opinions and of intentions and of egos. And maybe we should also go away from the ego to the wego, and then we have less arguments. This is an interesting wego building because it's a small housing addition to a house that was a small workers' house in a workers' settlement in Aachen. That's an industrial town in the west of Germany. And you see these little houses like this. It's a small house for a family, very little square meters, maybe 80 or 60, quite tiny for a family of four or five in our standards. And you see the building here, it's slightly enlarged. And you see also this type of fabric where there's always a garden and there's the house itself. Now, what I like about this project is the empathy of the architects that were asked to make this conversion, because it didn't look exactly flamboyant when they were asked to do so. It was a little bit run down, come of age, and yeah, you really didn't know what can you actually do with it. This is how it looked from the courtyard. Kind of bricolage over the years, so definitely not fancy. So the neighbor had already done something. You can see this kind of glass building. And this looked now like a little bit like the ugly duck. And the architects said, well, there's always something that you can do. And they turned out doing something which I find remarkable. They made this addition, which you see in this wireframe diagram here, in this axonometrics. And this is how the process went. They took away a part, the stable that was no longer useful to do, to have. They added this concrete frame to have an extension in the back, like this. They added onto that ground floor extension this bedroom extension. They inserted huge windows. This is still construction site photographs, but the interesting thing is the finished project doesn't look much different. Because, and this is, I think, is the beautiful thing, they didn't just literally prolong the existing building, but they made a change visible. And they didn't also cover this new material, the new bricks, to make it kind of nice. Right? So this building was presented as one of the best buildings in the German pavilion at the Venice Biennale a couple of years ago. And many people in Germany thought, wow, isn't this a disgrace? It looks like we cannot really build proper buildings. Well, I think this is a very, very proper building. Because it actually shows that this building has generations. You know, it is not just one biography, it's a series of biographies. And I love how they left the joint visible and how they've found a way how they can actually deal with these different dimensions of brick to accommodate the new extensions. So this is how it looks from the street. You see, this is the street facade. They all look the same, basically. They're modest houses, but still nice. And now this has become kind of special. And the best thing is obviously the courtyard, to the garden, where you have these spaces which are a wonderful extension to the life of this family that has now, especially this space I love a lot, which is kind of a winter garden. That wall is kept architecturally as it was before, so it reads as an outdoor wall. And so that you actually have the feeling you're outside the building, but not yet totally outside. Internally also, they made nice changes. What is red is new. And they found, especially in the section, many more spaces that allow you to put in other functions. So the bedrooms are organized with this ladder. So they use basically every cubic meter that you can possibly get. But you didn't need to demolish the building, because that would have been the other option, and to build something new. And I think it's quite amicable how they, you know, kind of made this building beautiful again, or to show a beauty that was inside. And it all started with this kind of drawing. Now, this is a part where you actually physically transform or add on the building. There's moments when you cannot do this. As for instance, in this case of this Belgium firm, 51 and Free, whom for me are one of the really most interesting young offices in the Western world. They had this residential house by two Belgium art collectors. And they wanted to have a guest house. And the building authority said, well, you cannot add any other building on your site. Your house is your house, and that's it. And let your guests couch surf and send them to a hotel. So they figured out a way, well, isn't there a way how we can change this still? And they found out a way that something which is quite interesting in our culture, I don't know if it works like here, whenever you do an art project, that is something else. Architecture, you always have trouble to get a permit. But you can make an artistic project, and it's much more likely to get through. There's a whole history of building transformations in the German or Austrian architectural history, and also in Switzerland, that were actually camouflaged as art projects. That's what the architects did here. They said, you know, what if we draw a wall around the building, this thing, I think it's 3 meters high, out of steel, and we declare it an art project. And that makes us gain space, because there will be a setback from the actual house to this wall. And that allows us to make a transformation of the house inside, and also to use the added space, the space in between, for some type of outdoor living. So here's what they did. That's the site plan. You see there's a very generous garden. So it's almost a very strange strategy to make a wall around, because it kills the view somehow. In our culture, this is quite weird to do, because the view is what you pay for. And I understand from the culture here, it's a much more interiorized notion of living. The outdoor space is often a patio, and it's inside the building, right? Now, let's look at how this house was before. It was like this, a very conventional cottage type of house. This was the garage. This is the kitchen. This is the living room, which is a very strange proportion. This is an outdoor kind of covered space. And I think that's yet another space. I don't remember exactly. What the architects did was this. So they pull out the wall around it, like this. They keep the garage, but then they take out some walls, as you can see, and they create this interesting space, which is some sort of a living room, but it's more than that. It's a living room that is also, that doesn't feel so private that you as a guest have a feeling you're invading someone's privacy. And they make a glass facade around here, which can partially be opened. And this doesn't seem to be much, but it changes actually a lot. First of all, the view. This is what you see when you come from the street. It tells you, wait, stop a little bit. But at the same time, it says, come inside. Because you know, this slit is always open. So the house is never actually really closed. So then you sneak inside, like some legal intruder. And before, what I did is I wanted to walk around, see this beautiful steel wall in its natural color. You come in the garden, and then you can actually see there's a gap so that people can actually see outside. You approach, you find this incredibly interesting, well-crafted, detailed facade. Maybe it's standing open, and the people who are very hospitable ask you inside, which is what they did with me. And you sit there, and you eat, and you spend time there for hours. And at one time, there's this beautiful moment in your subconscious where you think the boundary of the room you're sitting in is this white wall. Because in our culture, we often have white walls, as I think here too, since the tapestry had been declared unmodern. So you have the feeling the room that you're sitting in stretches until there. But actually, that's not true, because here, that is the glass facade. And this is a beautiful technique of enlarging a space without actually enlarging it. You just add another layer that defines the space in a different way as an outdoor device. And this is how this space, how this house became bigger without actually increasing its footprint. It's quite an interesting strategy, I think. So you can walk around. This is this this corner. These glass doors can actually go away. You can still walk around. And that's the front part of the house. Now, here is something really interesting. There's a change in the tiling, because these are wet tiles. Why would you have wet tiles outdoors of a house? Because they have a shower outdoors. In Bali, this is quite common, I heard. But in Belgium, it is not, because very often it's cold. But they shower every day. No matter how cold it is, they shower outdoors. It's something you can do because you have the wall that protects your privacy. But it produces a moment of surreal collage and kind of contradiction that I find a very interesting technique to also change a building, to allow it to change into something else. Because the most private part of this building is taken outdoors. There's also an indoor bathroom for like a shower, an indoor shower. So whenever you don't really quite feel brave enough, you can do that. But once you have an outdoor shower, you want to use it. And especially your guests want to use it. And It produces a moment where you understand that the entire kind of emotional zoning of the house gets put upside down. It's a very beautiful moment which is actually a change of programming, not so much a change of the physical structure of the house. But this house is, through this type of rezoning of private and public parts, and it is one example for how you can express change or how you can catalyze change without a physical transformation. Sometimes I think another strategy is to basically introduce an atmosphere that is foreign to a site. Now, this is a project in Germany that does this quite well, which is a very unusual kind of project because it's an office building inside a housing neighborhood. Now, normally we try to avoid this. We have zoning stipulations that say that in a housing neighborhood you shouldn't work, even though today we also question this rule again. Well, here they questioned that too and said, well, yeah, this site is okay for an office building, but at the same time, the rules for how to build this site stipulated that the morphological pattern of this 19th century housing neighborhood had to be kept up by the office building. That meant the volume of these buildings were kind of the model for the new project. Now, the program for this new project was too large to be fitted in any of these kind of buildings, and so they couldn't just make one big block. And in the end, they decided to cut these the program up into these shapes that have this kind of idealized shape of a house. So it's a type of a minimalist gesture, quite beautiful. And the other transformation that is introduced is on the level of material, because this is the building of the industries that work with metal in southern Germany. This is how this region makes their money for cars and machines and everything. So it's quite a rich client. And so that gave the architects the idea to really make them spend a lot of that money by using polished steel, inox, in a very thin form as the outside facade material to kind of express the identity of the client. And that produces a conflict to the entire neighborhood, which normally would not be tolerated in our building permit policies, because we have a paragraph in our building law that's number 34B. Every architect knows that if there's no building plan for a given site, the new building has to adapt to the character of the environment in all of its aspects. Here they didn't have to do this. I don't know how they bribed the permit, because we have that too. it's just more invisible. But they produced a conflict, which I think is quite interesting. This is this building that looks as immaterial as Arnold Schwarzenegger in Terminator 2, and is very thinly rendered. It's quite an unreal moment. So when you're on the site, you really want to touch the building, because you can't believe what it actually is. It's a beautiful feel, cold, unhuman, but quite appealing. But the most interesting thing, I think, is not the building in itself, but the tension. Oh, sorry, the tension that it produces to the neighboring building. The neighboring building being out of brick, as you see. And it's when I see these buildings, I have the feeling there's a poetry slam going on, or two rappers that have a beautiful musical argument with each other. Each one wants to outperform the other and say, "Well, I'm cooler than you," and it reminded me of a musician that I like a lot, Nitin Sawhney, who's a British-Asian musician of Indian descent, who works in his music always with these two identities of his native India and his current home in Britain. And he interweaves these characters of ancient cultures and contemporary cultures, East and West, in quite a remarkable way. He made a piece that shows this kind of dialectics that is at stake here in an almost diagrammatic beauty. I'm going to play you this song. It's very short, 2 minutes. And there's four different themes in these tracks, which alternate between these various cultures that we can associate with a long traditional Indian culture and and his contemporary environment, Britain, or let's say the West. It will be like, I have four credits that tell you what is going on, and I hope we can make this work. Sorry, I made a mistake here. Sorry, I messed it up a little bit. But probably you've understood it. It's just really this really beautiful play between traditional singing. Then there's this drum and bass that emulates the singing, and then there's the singers again that emulate the drum and bass line. And in the end, they play all together. Now this type of interweaving of various characters, I think, is something that happens at the same time in this building. It happens here as a dialectic between two buildings, but you can also have it, of course, in one building. In one building, which does that in a beautiful way, is actually a filmic example, which is Mon Oncle by Jacques Tati. I always liked this movie for its possibility to criticize or to formalize a critique of the modern movement without completely denouncing it, but it's like an empathic critique. You know this house probably, which is this kind of joke of progress. It wants to be ahead of its times in all kinds of ways, but produces a type of domestic environment that is not usable if you don't have an instruction guide. Now this is the problem, because the brother of this lady, who is the lady of the house, visits his sister and has really no clue how this new house of them works, and she is all day long busy maintaining the house, because it's quite a complex thing, and if you don't know how the kitchen works, you get your hand hurt. Now there's this beautiful moment where the identity of this furniture piece here is abruptly changed. When I look at it, it looks like, first of all, not a very elegant couch, secondly, quite uncomfortable. If I see this metal bar, I can imagine how it actually kicks me in the back and probably makes some pain. So she is not aware of this. However, her brother is, when at some evening he comes home, he's quite drunk, he comes from the pub. His sister and her husband went to the opera because they are high class people and they do these kind of things. So he comes back and he's so drunk. I know you cannot drink in Bangladesh, and there's severe reasons for that, but there's exceptional moments where actually that produces a higher moment of intelligence, as we can see in the following slide. Because he stumbles over this thing, rotates it accidentally by 90 degrees, and just falls flat on it, and voila, what do we have? A usable piece of furniture. Isn't this fantastic? It almost looks like a vernacular version of Le Corbusier's chaise longue, doesn't it? Like self-made in the garage. And now she is completely freaked out about this. And she says, and her husband says, well, look at your brother, how uneducated he is. He comes from the countryside, has no clue how to deal with progress, and so on and so on. But for me, he is the hero of that house. He is the first human being that actually makes sense of this house. And he does it basically by a behavioral change, right? Unconsciously, but nevertheless in a very sovereign manner. And I think very often buildings only start to make sense after they are delivered, and also by some accidental moment. Now, a moment where an intervention is made that has never been premeditated. And I want to finish the lecture with a project that I also did an exhibition about, and that is, to my mind, one of the most important case studies in contemporary Western architecture of the recent past. It is it's widely received and discussed, and I don't know if you know it here, but maybe not, and for that reason I want to show it to you. It's a building that had three lives so far. This is the first life of this building. It was a very beautiful modernist housing tower by Raymond Lopez, built in 1961 at the edge of Paris. And it had a beautiful series of different types of apartments. You can actually see the organization split level. So there's these parts are higher, then there's half a flight down, you go up and it goes up again. You can't see it right now because it's very beautifully made, not so obvious, by the various loggia that are placed here and there, which are double height often. Then there came some tragic moment where some politician had the idea, let's save some energy. And they did a transformation. This is basically, actually these slides are interchanged. Anyway, that's the title of the show. And they did this. This is the same building. Isn't this sad? And so what they basically did is they wrapped it in kind of thermal insulation, which later on proved to be containing asbestos. So it was actually damaging the health of the inhabitants. And it looked incredibly ugly. This building then degraded quite seriously socially. It was it became some kind of ghetto. It was nicknamed Alcatraz. That I think says something for a housing building. And people were starting to move out. And the owner of the building, the social housing, one of the social housing firms in Paris, thought about demolishing it. And before that happened, the architects actually said, well, no, we shouldn't do this. There's a possibility to make this building great again because it actually has a great core in its side. And they changed it into this. And I want to show you the process that led to this. It's quite an extravagant process. They took out the facade, this one. That was this faulty asbestos-containing facade with the thermal insulation and added this kind of 3-meter deep extension to it that also acts as a thermal buffer because it has a winter garden kind of volume perched between the inner facade and an outer facade. The inner facade is made of double glazing floor-to-ceiling sliding doors, and the outer facade is polycarbonate. Here you can see how this transformation happened. And the most important about this transformation is it happened while people were living in it because the architects wanted to make sure that people don't get kicked out because afterwards and cannot move in again because the client realizes that the project has become really beautiful. this took a week for each apartment, so a couple of months for the entire building. And then what basically was looking like this before looked like that afterwards. So you have to imagine everything from that point on is new, right? So this glazing was the place of the old facade. This was one of the old apartments with the then encased loggias, which turned out to be like that. So you have this, this is the winter garden space and out there is the balcony. You see that people basically accommodated these spaces, these extra spaces that were given in, you know, in addition, without the rent rising, by the way, because the energy cost of the building shrunk to 40% of what it was before. And so the auxiliary cost decreased a lot, so they could have a moderate net rent increasement, but overall they would pay the same. However, they would have about 40% more space. So everybody basically accommodated these spaces in different ways. Quite beautifully. This lady, which was 90 years old at that time and who had lived in the apartment for all of the building's life, she just decided that she could extend her living room and put a sofa out there. The interesting thing about the space, you have to imagine, is that it's not heated. It only it's passively heated by the sun. The difference that it makes is quite intelligent, because basically it means when the room temperature inside this building is 21 degrees in the winter and outdoors is -5, that means the indoor space or the in-between space will heat up passively to about 11 or 12 degrees. It's still too cold to really be comfortable outdoors, but if you take like a good sweater or something else, you can use that space, and that's what people do. So it became this quite extravagant collection of self-programmation exercises by the inhabitants. And just to give you an idea of how this would materialize in plan, this was the plan before, that's the plan afterwards. So basically these parts are the added ones here. And that means also every room in every apartment now has a direct access of the outdoors, which is a fantastic, I think, achievement. Now, so this is the project in itself. I think it's a wonderful, wonderful device, and they have made a series of other projects later after that, because a couple of politicians saw that and said, well, actually, we could use this device. And this was also an interesting moment of political resistance, because you have to know this whole project was developed as a protest against a political program by the French government, where they allocated 18 billion euros to demolish 500,000 housing units, all stemming from the 1960s, which were all inhabited. And the reason why that happened was simply because in the early 2000s, there were a couple of riots in France. And they often happened in areas where there was modernist housing complexes. And now, you could think when there's a riot and there's big protest, you could think about, well, what are the reasons for this? Maybe it has to do with the fact that people have no jobs, have no opportunities. that there's migration problems, that there's not enough other programs other than housing, there's not enough public space, and so on. You could come up with all those reasons, and they all are true to some degree, but the answer of the French president was, or his government, it's because of the architecture. Architecture is there to blame. So let's solve the problem by killing the architecture. Doesn't this make totally sense to you? So that was what they tried to do. They did it also to some extent, but these architects, Lacaton Vassal, said, no, this is actually really stupid. We all know that buildings are not culpable themselves. You cannot, a building is not a subject that you can blame to do something wrong. It's the people that do something wrong. So let's correct the mistakes of the people so that the building can perform its mission. This is, I think, utterly beautiful. They did a series of projects like that, and other architects now got inspired by that, and also mayors of different cities actually called them and said, well, I have a building here where you could help me. Now, but because I'm also a curator and now a director of a museum, I want to give you one example of how I like to work with architecture when I exhibit it. I was asked in 2012 by the German Architecture Museum to make an exhibition about this very project. Now, and then the problem is, first of all, I didn't know until that point, I really hadn't really thought about much how you make an exhibition about architecture. And the more I thought about it, actually, I had the feeling, well, how is this supposed to work? You can't exhibit a building. You can't exhibit architecture in the sense that you can exhibit an artwork where you take a sculpture or a painting and you just place it inside a gallery. In architecture, basically buildings are too big to do that, right? So if you really want to work with the building as a materialization of architecture, you have a quite hard time as a curator. So we have to find some kind of diversions, detours, translations. On top of that, the space that we were given to work with was exceptionally difficult to work with, because it already had an exhibition, a permanent exhibition, made by the architect of the building, Oswald Matthias Ungers, who thought that maybe an exhibition space of an architectural museum should also have a one-to-one kind of manifestation of architecture. And actually, I like that idea a lot. it only has the minor small side effect that there's almost no space left to make exhibitions in. But it's also interesting because in the beginning I cursed him for that. I said, why did you give us this challenge? And then, as you probably also know, whenever you have a really hard time, a challenge that impedes you to just repeat your routine actions, things that you have always done like that, then you're forced to be creative. Then you are inspired to reinvent yourself or the things you do. And this is what we had to do here. And this was beautiful. Because there was so little space, we had to find a way how to create some space. Because the mission that we had set ourselves for the exhibition was quite simple. Actually, this is, again, this is the size of that house volume. I mean, this is the house volume. These are these courtyards that give light to the floors below. And only this space here you can play with. And it's quite small. This is 11 meters. This is about 4. This is less than 1 meter. It's impossible. Curators go mad in this space or ask for another. We almost did the same, and then we didn't, because we tried to figure out, well, what is our story? What do we want to tell? Well, I want to tell the emotional drama that takes place, I mean, in a positive sense, when an inhabitant that has lived in this building for maybe 40 years, like this lady, Madame Dorsemen, whose apartment looked like this, quite run down, not very nice, in the 14th floor, with actually a beautiful view, except that you cannot really see it because the architect just made these very small windows. The tapestry doesn't look really nice. So when you are accustomed to a view like this of your apartment, and you come back that one day after the transformation has happened, after that 1 week, you turn the key, you open the door, and you see this. The feeling that goes on inside that person is the feeling that I want the viewer of that exhibition to re-feel. That was the mission. So that means we have had to find a way how to render this feeling of spatial extension that here is very beautifully manifest, because this was the old facade, and all this kind of light space behind came through the transformation. Now we said, okay, we have this house. We can't really work with this for that kind of goal. We have to do something else with it. Then we have the space that we can actually exhibit in. And so that would be the correlation of the apartment that was given before. Now that would make, you see, I'm trying to build up a spatial analogy between the existing of the building as such that we have to exhibit, or the apartment, and the museum plan. I try to make them identical, or like superimpose them. That makes the facade of this building the correlation of the old facade of the building, which was then replaced by the double glazing sliding transparent facade. And that would make that space the outdoor space around the building, which is all outdoor space of Frankfurt. That would make it the space of the extension in the actual building. If that is true, it means we have to demolish or replace that facade. Now you can't easily attack an Oswald Matthias Unger's building that directly. You have to find another way. And fortunately, there are images in architecture that help you create the sensation of space, even if the space isn't there. And this is what we did. We created a wallpaper that would run all around the walls of this building with this kind of sequence of photographs taken from inside the apartments. And we would print them in a scale of 1:1. Now the ceiling height of this apartment of these apartments in Paris is 2.50 meters. Therefore, we printed these photographs at a height of 2.50 meters, which gives you this 1:1 scale feeling. We tested this in the model, and it came out quite credible. We said, okay, we can do it. Let's try to do this. But we decided the wallpaper is not enough. You also have to create kind of a three-dimensional evocation of the domestic scene by furniture, plants, and other things. And this is how it looked in the end. Now, this looks really strange, I admit, for the time being, but wait a moment. Because when you go closer, it looks less theatrical and becomes astonishingly real, mesmerizingly real. But just to, this is important for you to show, to see the actual scene. You know, there's furniture, small chairs, and other things. There's a large bench placed in front of the image, and already here, you see when you're closer, these two layers, the layer of the image and the space in the image and the actual space in the gallery, start to communicate in some weird way. We can still see here that this is a three-dimensional object, and this is something more flat, but then there's also the plants, and then there's something more going on. Like this, you can still distinguish the elements quite well, but already you see the character of the objects that we inserted in the space, things we bought on eBay, you know, basically all used things. We took some of our own furniture and placed it there. Asked friends, a theater in Frankfurt helped us and lent us furniture. Actually, the character of this birdcage is very similar to this desk in the photograph. And this starts to create a complicity between representation and presence, which is kind of interesting. And the more you go close, the more you have the feeling you're actually in this apartment. And this is what people actually felt and how they lived this exhibition. This was a rather beautiful moment. So now you sit on the 17th level of this building, you look out to La Défense here, and there's traffic, only that the cars don't move, which you can't see here. And the moment where it really struck me for the first time is when we had finished this scene, which was quite difficult because it was a corner scene, and we placed this beautiful large chair there. And I thought, well, it's weird how the railing goes down on the ground. Does this really work? And then I asked one of our assistants, Elena, to sit down, and I made this photograph with my cell phone. And unconsciously, I didn't really think about it. I framed it in such a way that you cannot see the floor nor the ceiling. And then I looked at the image and said, wow, what's going on here? Which of the flowers are actually real and which aren't? I couldn't tell anymore. I had to look at the scene itself and say, okay, this is there and these are in the image. This one is real and the other ones are in the image. If you go there, how can you tell? And this moment, that's a very interesting thing. It's not something we premeditated. I wish I could say that we had this idea, but we hadn't. It's something that happened to us. And maybe because it happened to us as we were making this, it also happened to the visitors of the exhibition. Because they very quickly understood, it was already the time when you had cell phones, and people understood that the most important thing with the cell phone is obviously not making a call. But, you know, basically making photographs of yourself and your environment. People very quickly understood that you could make photographs this way, and they enjoyed this kind of difference to understand that here you can still see that this small little object and that chair are actually standing there because you can see how they stand on the ground. But as soon as they went closer and somebody was in the image, that was a bit hard to tell. Here, everything is clear. Here, not really clear. Especially the same thing here. There's a beautiful detail. You can see this is a handle. This is the handle of the door of the director of the museum, who everyone, every now and then, came out of his office. And you had people sitting in this on the sofa, which is real. This chair is not. And they thought, well, you know, this looks quite like a nice apartment because this is basically what we wanted the people to experience. We wanted them to have a feeling as if on Airbnb they live in some friend's apartment. Maybe they have a friend in Paris. He's gone on vacation. He says, you can have the key of my apartment. Make some beautiful vacations in my apartment. And that's actually the feeling that people had. They often stayed 2 hours in these places, reading our catalog and just enjoying the atmosphere of being there. And then wham! The director comes out of this, opens the door, and these guys almost have a heart attack because they think the aliens have arrived. This was quite an interesting moment. This is the architect, Anne Lacaton, having a fictitious conversation with her oldest resident. This is Ilka, my partner, testing the leaning capacities of this table, only to find out it's not there. And he or she performs the beautiful paradox of being in two cities at a time. Her feet are in Frankfurt in the Deutsche German Architecture Museum, and her hand is in the 17th arrondissement of Paris. Now, beam me up, Scotty, is become reality in architecture. we actually did something else as well in this thing. We actually also gave the middle space that we didn't really know what to do to an architectural graduate of Frankfurt who made just a thesis project to apply that very same methodology of Lacaton-Vassal's project in onto a building in Frankfurt that was threatened to be demolished. And he said, no, we don't have to demolish this. There's these French architects that just did this project. Can I not do the same? And she made the same thing as a diploma project. And we had seen this and we said, well, we have invited her to come into the museum, make this as her office. It looked like this. And work for 3 months after her thesis on this project to make a feasibility study, which we then presented to the president of the Frankfurt Housing housing society that had a large stock of housing and who owned that building in question. And I think now they're in discussion whether they actually realize her project. So this is also, for me, an important dimension of architectural exhibitions, that you actually can not only represent reality, but maybe change it. And we hope very much that soon we can contribute a little bit to that change. This is the museum that I have the pleasure to work in, the Swiss Architecture Museum, and this is where we want to host our show next year on Bangladesh contemporary architecture. And we hope that this exhibition will contribute to a fair amount to making this beautiful work that is done here more known in the world, and maybe have architects from here also build elsewhere. Why not in Switzerland? We have quite many building projects, and it would be kind of nice to have them built by someone from somewhere else. Thank you. So I was told that you can ask questions if you want. We have to prepare for that. Okay. So maybe I should fill the time a little bit. But I really don't know what to say. But actually, this is good because it gives you time to think up a question. Usually, this is always the problem. You know, usually there's a 2 minute break in silence when people are given the chance to talk to you. You have this 2 minute break before, so you can think up a question. That's good.
Hello, I'm Farhana from BRAC. I'm a student of fifth year, and I have a question about the last project you have shown. Mm-hmm. It's about all the pictures you have used are from day. I mean, it's from daytime.
True.
What happens at night?
People watch television and they don't want to be photographed. But it's an interesting question. I've never thought about this. This is really interesting. And you're right. Of course, one could also do that at night. It wasn't done in this particular case. It's interesting because I know a lot of photographs of houses that are actually taken by night. The Julius Schulman pictures of the case study houses in California, many of them are at night when they have their cocktail parties. It's true. Yeah, it's maybe, yeah. You know, we didn't do these photographs. We used the photographs that were done by the photographer of the architects, and we found them quite fitting also, because you have to say that the opening, during the opening hours of the exhibition, it would have been light outside, you know? And what we wanted to create was also this feeling of, we wanted people in Frankfurt to feel as if they're looking out to Paris. So we wanted to really, so they should see the city, they should actually recognize. And in some of the pictures, there are some iconic moments where you really do recognize Paris. There's the Eiffel Tower somewhere, and there's La Défense, and so on. But no, I think I can only take it as a great idea to do that in the future, because I think it's a fair question.
Thank you.
Any other question from anyone?
My name is Mizan, architect. Okay. I would like to ask you the initial slides, where you showed the old building is transforming with some ideas, with some new activities, and that was a fort possibly. And I have the perception from your lecture that what was your thinking that this architecture is successful is in only when it is live or something else, you think? Like, I think living quality, do you like to add this criteria to, okay.
Can you tell me which examples you referred?
Like some fort you showed in initial slides, in Netherlands or somewhere.
You mean this building?
No,
this isn't the one. That wasn't really Croatia. Is it this thing?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Okay.
So your question again, because I didn't understand it. So
okay, I would like to ask you what is the success? Is it in only in utilities or in function, or you have to think the living quality of people, or only in liveness of people? Like in our countries, we have old town where people are living in so dense condition. They have no such quality living, but they are living there. Mm-hmm. They are living there, but they have no quality.
Okay.
So how you think that, is it successful when the previous architecture or the first time architect create the building, and then the pirates occupied there, and they created the new new use of the spaces. So what do you think, which one is correct, or the livability is the only criteria or not?
I'm not exactly sure if I really understand the whole aspect of your question, but I can only tell, yes, I think it's very successful. I think why I like this building is that it proposes an alternative to a scenario that is much more common in our latitudes. When we have a historical building of value that is destroyed, or like an whole ensemble, like take for instance the Forum Romanum in Rome, you know, this big field of majestic ruins now, because of the cult of originality, often it is not possible to touch these ruins and to actually give them a second life. And so what we do is we conserve the ashes. I would like to keep the fire burning. And I think they have done this here beautifully, and this is maybe only possible because they did it so early in the 15th century, when we didn't yet have the Department of Landmark and Heritage Conservation, because today we are kind of forced to idolize and fetishize the remains of our past. And even if I can see a value in it, and these things also have a beauty when they are just ruins, perfectly true. But I must say this when I walk over the Forum Romanum, I have only a sensation of traveling to the past. There is not really a sense of presentness there. When I walk through the Diocletian Palace, I have both. The past architecture is perfectly present to me, because in its entire structures, it is there, you know, even if they're transformed. But they're very present, and they really have shaped this this thing. And actually, if you see this, where is it? Sorry, this one. When you see this view, what I find incredible, you can still see the traces of this building, even there where it's actually almost like immaterialized. So the structure of that ancient building has somewhat been written into the fabric that later replaced it or filled it. It's actually not a replacement. You know, it's like it's hollowing out and filling it again with other stuff. And I can only say when I see this fabric, actually when you walk around this place, this neighborhood, it's a very beautiful sensation. All these streets are beautifully dimensioned. The relationship between the heights of the buildings and the width of the street makes perfectly sense. The repetition of open spaces, you know, there's a whole logic to this type of pattern. You have this experience of going through this maze of buildings, and eventually you come into a larger space. And you can, then again, you are in some small hidden stuff, and then you come to a larger space again. So, and also the people that lived there, they didn't seem particularly unhappy. Actually, I was in a hotel there, I lived there for a week, and I felt really good. So I would say whenever we have a chance to not freeze frame the development of a building just because it doesn't work anymore in its original condition, but can give it a new meaning and a new life, I think we should do it. I'm skeptical whether the other alternative really is so much better, which would be to rebuild the building according to its original condition. For me, that's a little bit difficult to do. But when I look at the history of architecture, 80% of my favorite buildings have these kinds of multiple lives. And for me, this is quite beautiful to see that the work of like one mind, I mean, also we know that even, you know, no building actually is ever cooked up by one person. But let's say a building that follows in its three-dimensional definition one intention can take on other meanings and kind of dialogue over time with conditions that it could not have anticipated. And this, maybe I find this beautiful because I have a limited belief in the possibility of planning. I think that we can never really predict or anticipate future conditions. We can work towards those, and we have to. That's important. But almost in all cases, things will turn out another way. So therefore, I think it's very good to train ourselves in the art of adaptation, appropriation, and reinvention of existing structures. So yes, for me, this is one of the greatest successes in the history of architecture.
Okay, the last question would be from Menathavastam, I think.
I really don't have any question. I just have a comment. And that is, well, you talked about basically continuity of architecture, in a way, how architecture can continue through its life, through different times, and that are done in many different ways, like repurposing a project like the Reichstag, or, you know, here what you see is transforming it in a different way, like additive way, like you add more and reduce the scale to something much more inhabitable of a certain time. Mm-hmm. And then also you talked about appropriation and retrofitting. So these are all processes of keeping an architecture alive.
Yes.
And not taking it down and then bringing something up entirely new, which is sort of the what we are doing here in Dhaka, or mostly.
Okay.
Every time we have a site, the, you know, the building life here would probably be 20 to 40 years, and then we tear it down and we build a new one.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there is a lot to learn from these projects where you show that there are other possibilities of using these structures by repurposing them or retrofitting them and giving them new life or new meaning.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, let it go on through time. So I think this continuity of architecture is something we can take back from this lecture. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Salahuddin. And I think one of the...
Where are you?
I'm right here, right next to you.
Okay.
Okay, I know. Where is the spotlight on me?
Yes.
But I think what Marina was pointing out, it comes deeply from the way we are educated as an architect, or architects, because the kind of information an architect gets that provokes them to be too much into the ability to create something new. But the continuity of architecture is something that lags behind, and we perhaps put that job to the preservation and other disciplines. And here, listening to you and in some ways believing in what architecture should be, this is a fantastic way of sort of stitching back what has always been and will be. But in between these two worlds, you insert something that sort of allows you to be comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a maze project like this, retrofitting once a palace, now it's a living quarter. I think that gentleman who was trying to ask, what I gathered from his question, that the densification of what we have here is very different than the densification what you're showing there. So I think it would be wonderful to have some kind of video presentation of the walk that you may have taken through this palace and streets, where the scale came and the opening and the solid and void. And all that has to, architecture isn't about just building buildings, but it's about not building buildings. And that is something that perhaps, maybe not true, but perhaps often architects forget to do, what not to touch.
Well, the spatial experience of this place is not much different than going to old Dhaka, except in old Dhaka you have a lot of more stuff happening on the street space. You know, rickshaws and so on. Here's just Japanese tourists. which can also be quite filling in terms of their numbers, but I don't think that, I don't know if the comment was also maybe this is too dense, or it's too small, or too much filled with stuff. No, I don't think so. It's traditional cities are like these, and it's when there's little space, you adapt to it, and you walk not next to each other but behind each other. So that's, I think, it's perfectly fine, and it's I think there's a beauty in density that we have to make apparent to people, so that they don't feel they are oppressed by too much building stuff around. That we have in Switzerland, for instance, we also have a certain skepticism against density, and people, because it used to be a rural culture, not much different than Bangladesh, and so people lived in very kind of natural conditions. So whenever they come to the city, they have a feeling they have less space at their command, and they feel maybe approached too much. And some may even feel this is a claustrophobic condition. But I think there's a beauty in density that architects have to celebrate in a way that it will enchant the users of the cities. But of course, there is probably a critical threshold beyond which density is just a nightmare. I think I have experienced some of those thresholds in today's traffic condition here. So there I would say, yeah, one car less would also not hurt every other three cars. Yeah, but that's a whole different discussion.
My name is Tishti. I'm not a student of architecture, but I'm very interested in architectural theory. But when we are talking about architectural theory and theories of architecture, my question was, or my interest is, how theory does come to play when an architect practices the inarchitecturality, or when we in architecture, the architecture, I'm meaning the reconstructing the already constructed, encoding the already coded, or already decoded. So the decoding process or the reconstructing process out of the already constructed, the architectural, the structural, how does an architect, when he's practicing the architecturing, make sense of the affective categories, which is analogous to the shape of space or shape of time? So the shape of space and shape of time, how the inhabitant habitus of the architect himself, and how he is imagining the inhabitant he's going to incorporate within his desired space. So my point is, how an architect think of theories when he practices architecture, or what does it mean to say what is the theory of practice in architecture? Thank you.
Okay, quite a challenge.
We have just 3 minutes left.
Okay, good, great. So I don't have to give you the whole 30-minute answer that I would have just prepared. For me, you know, architecture and theory relate like a car and the lighting machine. You know, the machine that generates the electricity for the lamp of a car is driven by the engine of the car. It's the engine that drives the car forward. Now, there's a transmission device that also powers or makes a generator rotate, creating electricity, and which basically makes the lamp light. This is interesting, because at night, a car needs light to be able to know where you're going. And for me, architecture, the practice of architecture and the theory of architecture relate in that very same way. I think they are mutually dependent on each other. I think you cannot practice without theory, and you cannot theorize without practice. It also means the lighting machine in the car cannot run when the car isn't running. You know, the car has to drive. I mean, you have a battery that also allows you to basically have the lights on when when the car is standing. This is maybe the equivalent of that would be our memory. But basically, I think whenever architecture is not conceptualizing its practice in a certain type of theoretical framework, it risks of being not innovative and not experimental. By the same token, I think whenever architectural theory never anchors itself and drives itself from architectural practice, it risks to fall into the ivory tower of academia. So that's something that, for instance, never interest me. That's why I didn't do a PhD, because I was too impatient to stay in a university library for 5 years and be traumatized by my deadline. I actually learned about architecture from architects. At some point, I just realized that I had architects as my friends, and so they were telling me about their work, and I thought it was utterly amazing, and they would take me to building sites, and I started to enjoy the fragrance of freshly poured concrete, and I thought, wow, how sensual is that? You don't need to do much more than a raw construction and to have a space. Fantastic. And often, whatever is fitted in later on doesn't necessarily improve it. So, for instance, the way I actually came to architecture was like this. I went to an architecture school, not because I wanted to study architecture, but because there was a professor that I absolutely adored. He was actually a theoretician, Paul Virilio, a writer from France, and I just wanted to get to know this guy, and I chased him up on the staircase and said, well, can I work with you? I adore your work. However, the problem is I'm not an architect. And he says, you know, it's not a problem. Me not either. Still, I'm teaching at this architecture school. And so he allowed me, invited me to go into his atelier. There were 10 students of architecture. And they had to design a project for a semester. It was something about the Bauhaus, new Bauhaus. Now, I come from Germany, so I'm quite kind of familiar with the project. And he said, you can work with these guys and tell them something that they don't know about the architectural history. And you can think about the concept of the project. You don't need a draw. So this is actually how I worked for 3 months with these students. So we would discuss together, and I would try to develop like conceptual kind of framework, ideas, which then they would actually try to three-dimensionalize. And it was a very, very beautiful collaboration. And I have done this a number of times afterwards, when I was grown up, so to speak. And it's always a very, very beautiful process. And both parts can benefit from that. So my answer would be really, collaboration is the key. And understand that the very nature of the practice of architecture is not a solitary exercise. Drawing, maybe, but there's more to it. You know, there's the construction side. There's other people, construction workers, that will come into play and that will interpret your ideas and that may also change this idea. And it's important to not feel offended by those changes, but to understand it's a growing process, you know, and the minute you hand on an idea, it will also be reinterpreted by that other person. It's like the music of Beethoven today. We no longer know how he would have wanted to play it. We only know it through the interpretations of conductors and gifted musicians. So we no longer have access to this original structure, which I find quite amazing. In music, we kind of can live with the fact that we have lost the original, and that all that we can live with is the permanent reiteration of that composition in very different kinds of ways. And for me, architecture should be like that too. And the whole process of making architecture should be like that, that you start, at some point you have to start, you start a process and somebody starts with that, and then somebody else takes over. That happens in the architectural office, but it also happens outside when the building is done. And in that sense, for me, architecture is actually like a huge intellectual and physical chain reaction where the end, or the beginning and the end may not look a lot identical, but are inextricably linked by a whole sequence of chain-linked transformations. So that's what I would say.
Thank you so much, Andreas. It was an amazing talk, and thanks for being a very engaging audience. We have finished right on time. And we'll be seeing you again in February, we hope. Our next academic session is beginning. So keep an eye on our announcements in the mid-January or end of January, and join the programs. Thank you.
Thank you.